Hello all, welcome to VTO e-Sikshana program. I, Dr. Sasmita Mahapatra, is here to take the module 2, that is microwave network theory and microwave passive devices from microwave and antenna subject, which is a prescribed subject for 6th semester electronics communication and telecommunication students. So till now, we have studied the major differences between a normal network and a microwave network. And we saw that usually in a microwave network, we cannot use the Z parameters, Y parameters, H parameters, and ABCD parameters to analyze the circuits. So the major difference is being in a normal network, the signal is associated with low frequency. And usually in a microwave network, the signal is associated with a high frequency. So with respect to that, definitely we can tell that there are some differences and definitely there are some similarities between this S parameters, Z parameters and Y parameters. So in today's class, let us compare all these matrices and let us find out what is the similarities between them, what is the differences between them and what are the advantages of any matrix over the other matrix. So coming for the comparison. Now, usually impedance or admittance matrix, that is Z matrix or Y matrix for an input network represents all the circuit characteristics of the device at any given frequency. So usually it is with low frequency. But like the impedance or admittance matrix for one input network, the S matrix also provides the complete description of the network, as seen in case of an input network. So that also we have derived for an input network. We have got the S matrix. But there is a slight difference between this Z, Y and S matrix. While Z and Y matrices relate the total voltages and currents at the ports, in S matrix, we relate the voltage waves incident on the ports to those reflected from the ports. Basically, we have seen during the analysis of Z and Y matrix, either we go for the short circuit of one side port or the open circuit of one side port, and we try to find out what is the voltage across that port or what is the current across that port, and we try to find out the relationship between the input and output voltages or input and output current. But in case of S matrix, usually we don't only calculate the voltage and current. Rather, S matrix when we are using for a microwave network, since the frequency is very high, we are unable to take the readings with one open loop, with one open circuit or with one closed circuit configuration. So in that case, what usually we do, we try to find the characteristics of the microwave signal. So characteristics of microwave signal means we try to find out the voltage carried in the incident wave, the voltage carried in the reflected wave, and then we try to find the relationship between this incident and reflected wave of one port or one port to other port, and we represent them in terms of S parameters. So basically, S parameter is related to the wave. Z and Y parameters, they are related to voltage or current. Now, what is the relationship between them? So if you want to find out the relationship between them, we can get that S matrix has a relationship with impedance matrix, that is Z matrix, as S matrix is equal to Z matrix minus Z naught into unit matrix, whole into Z matrix plus Z naught into unit matrix whole to the power minus 1, which is equal to Z matrix divided by Z naught minus unit matrix into Z matrix divided by Z naught plus unit matrix whole inverse. Now, similarly, we can get the relationship between S matrix and admittance matrix, that is Y matrix, as S matrix is equal to unit matrix minus admittance matrix Y matrix divided by Y naught into unit matrix plus Y matrix divided by Y naught whole to the power minus 1. So these are the basic relationship between S matrix and Z matrix and S matrix and Y matrix. Now, coming for the common properties between S, Z and Y matrix. Now, if we see, usually the number of elements in all these matrix depends on the number of ports of the network. So if we have two ports, usually we represent it as a 2x2 matrix. Now when I tell 2x2 matrix, the number of rows and number of columns are going to be 2 and 2, thus carrying the total elements equal to 2 into 2, which is 4. So let it be a S matrix, Z matrix or Y matrix, the number of elements used to represent the matrix are always going to be same in all the matrices. Coming to the next common property, when it is a reciprocal device. So what is a reciprocal device? Already we have discussed in the first class itself. In a reciprocal device, when we give certain input at port 1 and we get the effect of that input in port 2. And now if we exchange, that is if we give the input at port 2 and we try to find out what is the effect of that input in port 1, the effects are going to be same. So basically, in any reciprocal device, we have seen and we have proved that the Z matrix, Y matrix and S matrix all are having reciprocity property. That means what? Zij is equal to Zji. Sij is equal to Sji. We have already proved it during the reciprocity theorem, during the reciprocal network for Z and Y matrix, and also as a property of S matrix. And we have proved that, in fact, this matrices, they are symmetrical. Okay, so this matrices, they are symmetrical, that is, we have already proved. So these are the common characteristics or common properties between S, J and Y matrix. Now, coming for the advantages of S matrix over J and Y matrix. In microtechnics, the source remains ideally constant in power regardless of circuit changes. So why we are telling it? Because usually the S matrix is taken for microwave techniques. Now, whenever we are going for a microwave network, usually the source can be a microwave source, klystron, magnetron, TWT or backward wave oscillator. Now, what is the power generated by the source are going to be fixed. They don't change. If at all, there are some changes in the circuitry. That is, if we connect some passive device or I remove some passive device, I make some changes, but the source is unaffected. The source continues to give the same power. Now, besides frequency measurement in this microwave network, we can measure even VSWR, power and pitch. Now, what is VSWR? Basically, whenever we have a microwave network, if we don't have the impedance matching, when I talk, it is my source impedance to characteristics impedance of the transmission line, again, characteristics impedance of the transmission line to the load impedance. If I don't have a matching, then I can have incident wave and I can have reflected. So when this reflection occurs because of impedance mismatch, then this reflection, when it superimposes on the incident wave, it results in a standing wave. Now in a standing wave, sometimes this output or this incident wave and the reflected wave, they come in phase, and at that time, the output, we tell it, it is maximum. And sometimes they are out of phase, and at that time, the output becomes minimum. So depending on whether the signals are in phase, we are going to get maximum output. When the signals are out of phase, we are going to get minimum output. Now if we take a ratio between this maximum and the minimum, then that is represented as VSWR. Okay? So in a microwave network, in order to know the efficiency of the network, it is very important to find out the VSWR, because always we want that the loss should be less, the reflection should be less. So how much efficient is the device or the circuitry, it is found out depending on VSWR. Then power, as usual, we should always know what is the transmitted power, that is the power related to incident signal, reflected signal. And of course, if there is a change in phase of the wave, so wave is propagating, whether there is a change in its propagation direction or phase, then that also should be measured. Now, when we are using S matrix, we are going to represent or we are going to measure all these parameters by using only two terms. One is my amplitude of incident wave. So incident wave amplitude, as earlier discussed, usually it is represented as A. And one is the reflected wave amplitude, which is represented as B. So by using this A and B, we can calculate all these parameters, whatever we want to calculate in a microwave network. So we can calculate VSWR, that is the maximum voltage divided by minimum voltage, if we know A and B. We can find out the power, the incident power, the transmitted power, the reflected power, everything, if we know these factors, and even the phase also. So the calculation, the measurements becomes very easy, because depending only on two factors, we are able to find out all other measurements. So it becomes very easy when we are using S matrix. But the same thing is not going to happen when we are using a Z matrix or we are using a Y matrix. Because in case of Z matrix and Y matrix, in order to have a relationship, we should know the voltage, current, sometimes the current gain, sometimes the voltage gain, all these things. So the things are not so easy as it is very easy in case of S matrix. And coming to the next advantage, the unitary property of S matrix. It helps a quick check of the power balance for a lossless structure. Okay. So we have already seen the property of unitary property of S matrix. So usually it helps us to check whether the system is lossless or not. But usually whenever we are using Z and Y matrix, we don't have such kind of option to find out. Next, coming for the other advantage, S is defined for a given set of reference plates. We have seen that. We have taken many networks. I have shown you certain device, the junction, and I have shown you the phase shift property and all. So what we have taken is, whenever we are trying to find out the S element, the S matrix elements, it depends on certain reference planes. So if the reference planes are changed, they are getting shifted, then the path covered by the wave is going to change. So because the path covered by the wave is changing and the wave is always associated with certain phase constant, so the wave propagation or the phase associated with the wave is also going to change. So when we are going for S parameter analysis or S elements in S matrix, when we are going for shifting the reference plane or the reference plane is changed or shifted, we have only the change in phase of the S coefficients. But in case of Z and Y matrix, because the voltage and currents are functions of complex impedance, the voltage and current, they are dependent on impedance and admittance. And these values are complex quantities. So we have to consider the magnitude as well as the phase in case of Z and Y matrix. So the calculation is not going to be that easy as it is very easy in S matrix, since there is only the phase change, there is no change in magnitude. So these are certain advantages of S matrix over Z and Y matrix. Now, let us discuss certain problems related to this J, Y and S matrix. So coming to the first problem, the first problem is something like this. We have two transmission lines. So with characteristic impedance Z1 and Z2 joined at plane PP. So here are the two transmission lines we have considered. So this is my first transmission line. It is associated with characteristic impedance Z1. And here I get the second transmission line. It is associated with the characteristic impedance Z2. Now these two transmission lines are joined at a plane P, P dash, as you can see. Okay. Next thing is, express the S parameters in terms of impedance. So we have to put the S parameters in terms of Z parameters when each line is match terminated. So what I mean by that is, if I'm taking this is my transmission line, the characteristics of impedance of this transmission line is Z1, and this transmission line is ended with one ending impedance of Z1. So this transmission line is matching. This Z1 is equal to Z1. So it is one matching transmission line. It will not give us any loss. Again, coming to this side, if I'll see, so this is my characteristics impedance of this transmission line, which is again ended with a resistive load or an impedance, a load with impedance Z2, and these two impedances are also matched. So we have match termination done at both the transmission lines. Now let us see how we are going to do it. So usually, according to S parameter, we have a relationship between the reflected wave and the incident wave, which is very common, and we have discussed it. So B equal to S into A. Now let us take that and let us find out the incident voltage and the reflected voltage at each of the port, and let us find out the different S parameters. Now we have seen that the output line is matched. That is my port 2. If I'm telling, I have told you Z2 is equal to Z2. So output line is matched. So since my output line is matched, what I'm taking, I'm considering my A2 is equal to 0. Output line is matched. So let us have that. We don't have any incident wave at port 2. Now the input impedance Zin at the junction is equal to Z2, equal to load for the line Z1. So when the input impedance, so in this end, so from the input side, from the transmission line Z1 side, when it is matching, so we can tell that the input impedance at this junction, if I'm considering this junction, so the input impedance at this junction is equal to the Z1, the impedance coming from port one side or from transmission one line and from transmission two line. So we can write quickly that Zin is equal to Z1 is equal to Z2. Now let us find out what is the reflection coefficient. So at port one, so at our transmission line one, we're trying to find out the reflection coefficient. That is a relationship between B1 and A1. Okay. So if I look at that V1 by A1, the reflection coefficient, which is written as S11. So that is usual. The equation for reflection coefficient we already studied in module 1. That is equal to ZL minus Z0 divided by ZL plus Z0. The reflection coefficient is given as ZL minus Z0 divided by ZL plus Z0. Where ZL is equal to load impedance, Z0 is the characteristic impedance of the transmission line. So in this case, when I look at this side for the my transmission line one, if I look, so my load impedance and characteristic impedance is Z1. So accordingly, we can write that ZL is equal to Z2, the load impedance we are replacing here by Z2, minus Z1, which is the characteristic impedance of transmission line one, divided by Z2 plus Z1. So this is our S11, the reflection coefficient at port 1. Now, similarly, if we go for the symmetrical condition and we look, assuming input side is matched. So input side is matched means we can take A1 equal to 0. So initially we took output side is matched and we took A2 equal to 0. Now taking A1 equal to 0, so what we can write is our S22, or that is the reflection coefficient at port 2 is again going to be ZL minus Z0. So since we have come to port 2, so here ZL is going to be Z1 and minus Z0, the characteristic impedance of the second transmission line, which is Z2 divided by Z1 plus Z2. Now if we compare these two equations, Z2 minus Z1 by Z1 plus Z2, and here we have got Z1 minus Z2 divided by Z1 plus Z2. So if we compare these two, then we can see that S22 is equal to minus S11. Okay. Now the standard equation for reflection or for S parameters in terms of your port 1 and port 2, we can write it as V1 is equal to S11A1 plus S12A2, V2 equal to S21A1 plus S22A2. Okay. Now, with output line matched, as we took the first condition, A2 equal to 0. So this term, if you are taking it equal to 0 for a lossless line, Z in at the junction is equal to Z2, a pure shunt element. So if we are considering A2 equal to 0, so at the junction we can take Z in is equal to here. The Z in will come here is equal to the characteristic impedance Z2, because the port 2 we are taking it as properly matched. Okay, so if we'll replace that in this equation, so if we'll make A2 is equal to 0, now in that case, B1 is equal to S11A1. Okay, now due to different impedance in the arms, we can find out what are the values of these parameters, S parameters. So we can have here a standard equation Z2. Square root, that is we are equating from port 2 to port 1. So we can write Z2 square root into B2, because it is actually B2 plus A2. But since we are considering our A2 port is, or the second port is matching, so A2 we have put it equal to 0. So we can write here that Z2 into B2, Z2 square root into B2 is equal to A1 plus B1 into Z1 square root. Right? So now replacing the values here, A1 and B1, as here you can see, equating A2 equal to 0, we have got it equal to S11 into A1. So replacing that value for B1, we can get here into Z1 square root. So taking A1 common, we got this is the value for Z2. Now if we take the ratio of this, that is B2 by A1. So that is what B2 by A1 gives us the parameter S21. So if you are taking it, that is equal to 1 plus S11 square root of Z1, Z2. Now, what is the value of S11? Already we have got in the previous part only that it is equal to Z2 minus Z1 by Z2 plus Z1. Now, replacing the value of S11, we can get here S21 equal to 1 plus this Z2 minus Z1 by Z2 plus Z1 square root of Z1, Z2. If we simplify, that gives us 2 into square root of Z1, Z2 divided by Z1 plus Z2. Okay, so that is our S21. Similarly, we can find out S22 and we can find out S12 also. So S22, if we look for S22, so we have to take the matched impedance condition in port 1, that is making A1 equal to 0. So we can again minimize this equation for B2, making A1 is equal to 0. So B2 is equal to S22 into A2. Now using that, we can have here again the same equation from the input side. So it is Z1 square root A1 plus B1 into this path. Now here the A1 goes to 0. So making that, we can again replace the value of B2, which is equal to A2 S22. Now replacing that, we can solve and we can find out the value of Z1 square root into 0. Now, if we'll take a ratio of B1 by A2, so this gives us this equation, and we have already got what is the value of S22. So replacing that value, we can find out a value of S12. So now we have got S11, S12, S21, and S22. Now let us replace all the values and find out the final S matrix in terms of Z parameters or Z elements. So we can have, this is the relationship where we have replaced the values of S. So everywhere we have taken the values of S matrix. So S matrix, usually as we have considered as two port. So it is S11, S12, S21, S22. We have taken all the four parameters. Now S11, already we have got S11 value. So Z2 minus Z1 by Z2 plus Z1 that we have replaced. Then we have got S22 value, that is Z1 minus Z2 divided by Z1 plus Z2. Then we have got S21 value, which is 2 into Z2 Z1 square root by Z2 plus Z1. And we have got S12 value, which is again 2 into Z1 Z2 by Z1 plus Z2. So replacing those values, we can have, this is our final S matrix for this network. Okay. And here one thing can be seen, that S12 is equal to S21, that is giving us the symmetrical property for a reciprocal network condition. Okay. Now, coming to the next problem. So next problem, what we are trying to do is determine the S matrix of a 3DB T network. So we have tried to show here a T network, as you can see. So we can see here a T network. Okay, we can see here a T network. And in this T network, we have 3DB T network means the overall, the power loss when we take at the cutoff frequency, we are taking it as 3DB. And the network is terminated in 50 ohm. So both the sides, if we'll see the characteristics impedance here, Z0 is 50 ohms. And here the characteristics impedance is 50 ohms. The network is terminated with 50 ohms with Z1 or Z, the first, this one is Z, only Z. Z is given as 17.12 ohms. And Z2 value is given here as 141.78 ohms. So we have to determine the S matrix for this network. Okay. So now let's see. We will start from port 1 once and port 2 once, and then we'll try to combine. Fine. So coming for Z1 value is given, or Z value is given. So each place we have written Z half. So let us find out what is the value of Z half. So it is Z1 by 2. We have taken it as 17.12 by 2. So we have got the value of the resistance is 8.56. Now let us find out all the parameters one by one. The first S parameters is S11. So what is S11? It is the reflection coefficient at port 1, which is the reflected voltage at port 1 divided by the incident voltage at port 1. So the reflected voltage is given as V1 minus divided by V1 plus, which is the incident voltage, or incident voltage carried by the wave. And here V2 plus is taken as 0. So that is equal to my reflected wave is V1 divided by the incident wave is A1. Okay. So if we look at this once again, the equation goes same. So the reflection coefficient is ZL minus Z0 divided by ZL plus Z0. So if we look at this port 1, so my ZL is the impedance looked at the input side, that is my input impedance if I'm taking it Zin, and the characteristics impedance if I'm taking it as Z0, then we can replace it equal to Zin 1 minus Z0 by Zin 1 plus Z0. Now the question is, what is the value of Zin? Because Zin is not given and Z naught is given. So in order to find Zin, so what we have taken, it is equal to my Z1 by 2. So which is coming so total we have taken it into two parts. Let me write it first, Zin. One is I'm considering Z1 by 2. And here I have taken a parallel combination of this resistances. Okay. So how I have taken here is, let me write the equation. So this is my Z1 by 2 we have taken, plus this is we have taken the value 141.78 is, if you look at this port 1, so we can see very well that Z0 is series with Z1 by 2, and together these two resistors are in parallel with Z2. Okay, so first what we have taken, we have added these two impedances, we have added these two since they are in series. Then the total addition, we have taken it parallel with respect to Z2. So that is what we have done here. So we have added these two resistance. You can see that is for series combination, and this series in parallel with this. So we have taken Z2 is parallel with respect to your Z1 by 2 plus Z0. So this is the equation that we have used. And finally, we got the equation Zin 1 equal to 50 ohms. Now, if we'll replace that for S11 calculation, Zin 1, if we'll replace it here, then S11 we are going to get is equal to 0. Now, if we'll take the symmetry property, so S22 is also going to be 0. So that means what? When S11 equal to 0, that means what? My V1 minus is equal to 0. And when I go for symmetry property and I'm taking S22 equal to 0, so V1 minus is equal to 0, I'm considering the condition is when V2 plus is equal to 0. This condition we are taking when V2 plus is 0. So quickly, we can come to one conclusion that when S11 is equal to 0, that means there is no reflection at port 1. Okay, when there is no input is given at port 2, there is no reflection at port 1. Now let us find out the S matrix S21. Now what is S21? It is the ratio of the reflected voltage or reflected wave at port 2 divided by the incident voltage at port 1, keeping the incident voltage at port 2 equal to 0. Now, if we try to find out this, so similarly, we have to find out the voltage V1, the total voltage at port 1, which is equal to V1 plus V1 minus. Now, V1 minus already we have got is equal to 0. In the previous case, we got S11 equal to 0. So, this we got it at 0. So, V1 is nothing but V1 plus. Similarly, V2 equal to V2 plus V2 minus. And here we have taken the condition V2 plus is equal to 0. So, we get that V2 equal to V2 minus. Okay. Now, in the same way, we have to find out what is the impedance at the output port side. So output port side, again, the condition is going to be same. The Z0 is in series with Z12 and the Z1 by 2, and together they are in parallel with Z2. So taking the same condition here, so here Z0 is already given 50 ohms. Taking the same condition here, again, we can find out that 50 plus 17.12. So that is our, here we are writing it is nothing but Z0 plus Z1 by 2 is in parallel with our value of Z2. Okay. So, yeah, it is in parallel with Z2. Now, replacing the values, we can get what is the impedance at the output port. Now, we want to find out the voltage appearing at the output port, that is the reflected voltage appearing at the output port. And that is nothing but equal to V2, since V2 plus we have taken it equal to zero. So now we have applied a voltage divider rule across the output port. So input voltage we have got from the input side, we have got voltage V1. Here we want to find out V2 dash. We have, these are the impedances lying in the port 2. So let us apply a voltage divider, which is going to give us what is the voltage appearing across Z2 and what is the voltage appearing across Z0. And that will give us a voltage, which is my reflected voltage at port 2. So if we are applying that, we can see here, for that we have taken here the total output impedance, we have considered 41.44. So that the voltage drop across that into what is the voltage drop across the output characteristics impedance, we have got the voltage is equal to 0.707 into V1. So we have got a relationship between V2 minus by V1 plus, but previously only we have seen that V1 plus is nothing but V1, so which is equal to 0.707, which gives us the value of S21. So we have already got S11 is equal to zero, and we have got they are symmetric, and we have got S21, so S21 equal to S12. Now writing the final S matrix, so since S11 equal to zero, S22 is also taken as zero, and S12 is taken as S21. Okay, so that ends with this problem. Now with all this discussion, let us have some recommended questions coming from this part. How much portion we have covered till now? Four classes. This is the fourth class. So within this four classes, we have mainly covered what is microwave network. So with respect to that, let us find out what are the expected questions. So one question can come, explain the relationship between incident and reflected wave in terms of scattering parameters for a two-port network. So scattering parameters S11, S12, S21, S22 are the scattering parameters for a two-port network, and how they are related with respect to incident and the reflected waves. And also you can have an explanation for physical significance of S parameters, why we use S parameters. Okay. So you have to explain what is S parameters, what is the significance of S parameter, and for a two port network, you have to find out all the S elements, the elements of the S matrix. Next, which properties are common in S, Z and Y matrices? So just now we discussed the common properties. Next, two transmission lines of characteristics impedances Z1 and Z2 are joined at plane TP dash. Express S parameters in terms of impedances. So just now we have done that problem. The first problem we have done that. So the same problem has been asked. And then state and explain the properties of S parameters. Very often I have told you while discussing S parameter also that it is a very, very important question that what is the properties of S parameters. So you have total five properties. You have discussed all of them. Wherever there is a proof, you have to prove it. Explain S matrix representation for multi-port network. So we can take one N-port network and we can find out how the S matrix can be used for representing this N-port network. Then, what are the advantages of S parameters over Z and Y parameters? So that is what we already discussed in today's class. So this portion completely deals with the microwave network theory part. So what is a microwave network and how S parameters can be used for analyzing the microwave network. In next class onwards, we will start with microwave passive devices. So those are the devices which are going to be connected in a microwave network to complete the system. Okay. So thank you till that. So see you soon.